Thank you for allowing me to be with you today. I know it has been a long day and this is the last talk, so I will try my best to be as quick as possible. In children, basic knowledge is learned through different senses. Sight accounts for more than 80% of the knowledge that is learned by these children, and the remaining 20% is for the other senses. In spite of this, a recent report published in 2015 showed that all children in the United States are tested for hearing in infancy, but most children do not undergo vision screening until they enter kindergarten, which may be too late for positive intervention to address certain conditions. And this is mostly is similar in Jordan. Traditionally, when we look at children's eye, when we do the eye examination for children, we look at the structure and the function of the eye. So we check for the red reflex. So we check for the red reflex at birth, which is a very important test, simple and informative, and I will be talking about it in a minute. We do external inspection of the eyes and the eyelids. We look for ocular motility, and we do pupillary examination. And then for vision, we do general visual behavior assessment. We do this assessment through observing the response of the infant to light. An infant blinks when a bright light is shown into its face. We look at the pupillary responses to pin light, and importantly, we try to assess the ability of the infant to follow a target, be it a face, a light, or a toy. A formal visual acuity test is done mostly at school age, or this is what was done till recently, with the emphasis on refractive errors and amblyopia. However, in doing so, we missed many patients and many conditions were diagnosed late. And as you know, in amblyopia, early detection makes a tremendous difference in the prevention and treatment of this condition. For this reason, the screening was moved from school age to preschool age, around the 3 years old preschool or kindergarten examination. And at this age, it's sometimes difficult to get the child to answer the usual visual acuity chart testing. So we use different methods, including the Lea test, matching puzzles, and so on, to detect vision. And we do the test for each eye separately to make sure that both eyes see well. However, even with this, we were still missing the first 3 years of life. And for this reason, this prompted the development of the photo screeners. With the introduction of the photo screeners, we can now screen for refractive errors around 1 year of life, even a little before that, 6 to 12 months. A photo screener is an instrument that takes photographic image of the eye's red reflex and some other measurements to estimate the refractive error of the eye. And with over the last decade or so, these photo screeners have developed and became more and more accurate and give better data. These photo screeners may also detect ocular misalignment and other conditions degrading or blocking the line of sight, like cataract. And there are recommendations on when to refer infants for further evaluation by an ophthalmologist. Oops. So if an infant has astigmatism more than 2 diopters at 1 year of age, or more than 4.5 diopters of hyperopia, more than 2.5 diopters of anisometropia, difference between the two eyes, or more than 3.5 diopters of myopia, then they need to be further evaluated. As well, the photo screeners can show media opacities or strabismus, and in case these were detected, then again, further evaluation needs to be done. And this is for infants 1 year old. Going back to the red reflex examination is a simple, quick, easy, and informative test that I'm sure all the neonatologists now do for their newborn infants. And basically, the red reflex should be bright and equal in both eyes. In both eyes. If the red reflex is brighter in one eye and dimmer in the other eye, this may indicate a difference in the refraction between both eyes. The red reflex test can be done for one eye at a time or can be done for both eyes together, and it's done by the pediatrician standing around 60 centimeters from the face of the infant and shining light through the ophthalmoscope. More importantly, the absence of the red reflex. If we don't find a red reflex, this may indicate media opacities, most importantly, a cataract. We can also detect corneal abrasions or corneal foreign bodies showing as black dots or lines on the background of the red reflex. The red reflex can also show us strabismus if the corneal light reflex is not in the center of the pupil in both eyes. But in spite of all these data that we get from the red reflex, we are missing a lot. Basically, we are missing all the retinal diseases that can happen or can be found in the newborn. For this reason, many studies around the world, including China, India, the States, and Australia, assessed the benefit of digital imaging of newborns and found a significant number of missed eye diseases. And the results of these studies were published over the last decade. The first one of which is the UNEED, the Universal Neonatal Eye Examination Digital, and it showed a high percentage of retinal hemorrhages in infants, macular hemorrhages, and other conditions. Retinal hemorrhages accounted for 21%, or were seen actually in 21% of infants screened. Other conditions, including abnormal fundus pigmentation, optic nerve diseases, idiopathic retinal venous tortuosity, congenital cataracts, opacities of the cornea, persistent fetal vasculature, and retinal masses like retinoblastoma were detected in nearly 2% of infants examined. The universal screening of more than 15,000, this study was continued over 4 years and included over 15,000 healthy neonates and found an overall incidence of abnormal eye pathology in 23% of infants. This included 21% retinal hemorrhages and nearly 2% other pathologies. Potentially vision-threatening macular hemorrhages occurred in 3% of these patients when screened before the age of 28 days. A similar study, the newborn eye screen testing study based at Stanford University, is now attempting to verify these findings in the US population. Initial results showed similar percentages with birth prevalence of fundus hemorrhages in 20.3% and fovea involved in 3% of the newborns examined. Another study, the Global Universal Eye Screen Testing study, is seeking to validate the technique of universal eye screening using images from around the world. So in a comprehensive screening of the newborn, we do blood tests for different pathologies, we do hearing assessments, we do general examination, eye examination, and others. When looking at the prevalence of these diseases, we see that the disease like phenylketonuria occurs in 0.004% of patients, hemoglobinopathies in 0.1%, hypothyroidism in 0.06%, cystic fibrosis maybe in 0.04%, and hearing loss in 0.2%, 1 in 500. The incidence of eye diseases is much higher than the incidence of other screened conditions such as hearing or metabolic impairments. Again, going back to retinal hemorrhages, the reported incidence in different studies is between 20 and 25%. Most of these hemorrhages are benign and resolve in 1 to 2 weeks. However, nearly 20% may persist for longer duration, and macular hemorrhages occur in 2 to 3% of infants. And as you can see, this is an image of macular hemorrhages covering most of the fundus. Now, most hemorrhages resolve, as I said, quickly. However, denser hemorrhages may stay for longer periods of time. In this image, you can see diffuse hemorrhages covering the back of the eye, including the fovea, the center of vision. Now, in 3 weeks, all the hemorrhages resolved except the foveal hemorrhage. And this may limit normal optical development, potentially resulting in visual disturbances such as anisometropia and amblyopia later in life, conditions that we see in children and sometimes cannot explain to parents why it happened in this child in particular. And now there are several theories being postulated that retinal blare early in life may have a profound impact on normal optical development and immotorization of the eye. Other conditions that we see a fibrovascular ridge, retinoblastoma. This is a very early retinoblastoma. This is how it starts, and it can be seen. It was found in a screening of an infant. A larger retinoblastoma, again, this is only seen by examination of the fundus. When we say retinoblastoma is diagnosed, one of the presenting symptoms is leukochondria. To have leukochondria, you need a tumor that is at least 5 times the size of this tumor, covering most of the area of the macula, which means that it is diagnosed at a much later stage. We can also see salt and pepper changes indicating infectious or metabolic diseases, as well as imaging of the anterior segment showing cataract or iris abnormalities and microphthalmia. The way we were able to do these screening tests is by using a RETCAM. A RETCAM is a specialized contact camera for imaging of the retina of infants. It was initially used for ROP screening, and over the last 1.5 decades, proved very efficient in reducing the vision loss that was associated with ROP through screening in distant areas, especially in the third world countries. It gives high definition images and is easy to transport. The best time to do the test is during the first week of life, but it can be done later if missed. And the best place to do is in the nursery while the baby is still in the nursery during the first few days of life. The examination is performed by a team consisting of a trained ophthalmic technician and assisted by a nurse, and the images are then interpreted by an ophthalmologist. A report with photos is generated within 48 hours and sent to the parents and the pediatrician. So we dilate the pupils with 0.5% tropicamide, and then topical anesthesia is instilled. The anterior segment images are taken, and then a sterile eyelid speculum is placed in the eye. And using the RETCAM wide-angle images, wide-angle digital fundus camera examination is then done, and photos are taken for the posterior pole, the upper, lower, temporal, and nasal parts of the retina. And this is how the report then is produced. Is it a safe test? The study in China, over 15,000 children, looked at the ocular and systemic complications of the test. The test usually takes less than 5 minutes after the pupil is dilated. Ocular complications occurred in subconjunctival hemorrhages in 4 patients, and then palpebral conjunctival hemorrhages in 1 patient out of 15,000. None had corneal epithelial defects, and none had corneal opacities. Looking at the systemic complications, 9 out of the 15,000 vomited. Transient apnea, not requiring treatment, occurred in 8 patients, and these patients had the test done half an hour later. transient cyanosis in one patient, and no reported tachycardia or bradycardia needing medical intervention. There was no need for intubation and no mortality. And this is, again, not in preterm infants. This is in full-term, healthy newborns. So the early identification of treatable ocular disorders, such as congenital cataract, glaucoma, persistent pupillary membrane, Coats disease, and retinoblastoma, can result in better visual outcomes and prevent serious visual complications in the newborn. Furthermore, early treatment of retinoblastoma can also be life-saving. In untreatable conditions, such as congenital anomalies of the disc, these images can also prompt other associated neuroimaging or endocrine investigations to reduce the impact of poor and delayed developmental outcomes. And in diseases like microphthalmia, it can prompt further genetic investigations. Images taken in normal children, the background data of these images taken during the neonatal stage can also provide useful information as a reference for cases of ocular pathology that are detected later in life. So in conclusion, photo screeners are recommended for screening vision at 1 year of age. They do give higher or some false positive results, but they are sensitive, reasonably sensitive. The retcan fundus image is safe and beneficial screening test. As part of a comprehensive newborn health examination process, it may prove invaluable in discovering pathology at an early stage. The treating neonatologist, pediatrician, obstetrician, and hospital staff are essential in creating awareness among the mothers and families of the babies for both possible benefits of having these tests done. And finally, the best time to refer a baby to an ophthalmologist is when they can actually intervene to improve vision. Early detection of certain eye conditions can save vision and sometimes save life. Thank you.